Welcome to Majority Rules. This is season one, episode 15, I think. That seems right. This is a podcast about Mizzou Athletics Majority, which is Olympic sports athletes. Got a couple of the gang here who drop them like flies around here. People have work, studying, other commitments. Their sports aren't really newsy right now. So it's just the three of us. I'm your host, Karen Steger. I'm the softball, gymnastics, and sometimes swimming beat writer and Olympic sports manager at rockmnation.com. And over there, other way.
Oh, God. We're figuring it out. Mirrors are, they work crazy ways. I am Dylan Heinrich. I am the soccer / women's basketball beat writer for Rock M Nation. So got a bunch more women's basketball games to talk about on the deck that have happened previously and are continuing to happen in our near future.
And I'm Matthew Gustafson, the volleyball and wrestling, alongside second baseball and sort of emergency third swim and dive beat writer at Rock M Nation.
Thank you guys for coming. Since we will be off next week, so everyone can celebrate the Thanksgiving holiday, we should probably start out with something about Thanksgiving. Matthew, you have a question?
Yep,
for the masses? So, the masses being the other two people here.
So the two questions.
Okay.
Number one, favorite Thanksgiving side dish. Number two, favorite Thanksgiving dessert.
Those are good. So I guess I can go first because I'm here as well. Give me some time to think. We've talked about this with various members of our circle. I believe that the best Thanksgiving exclusive food is a green bean casserole. I think that it's just I see the face. I know the judgment, Karen, but it's the green
bean casserole fan.
the cream of mushroom. The onion shredded, the fried onions that go on top. It's a perfect little bit of mix of everything that you can kind of claim as healthy. So you can eat as much of it as you want. And then for dessert wise, I think you always got to go with a pie. I think that I'm personally not a pumpkin fan, so that will not be my choice, but I definitely pick any of cherry, apple, or pecan. Those are your top three in my book.
Okay. Backstory. On the way to the grocery store, he kept calling it pecan pie. And then now all of a sudden he's on air. All of a sudden he's on air. He says pecan.
Pecan. Pecan. I've always said pecan. I never said pecan.
Okay. Oh, pecan. It's pecan pie, which
it
by
is
the way,
pecan pie.
Is my favorite personal, dessert. Okay. My family, you know, it's a recipe that is passed down from my great aunt. My grandmother makes a phenomenal pecan pie. And then favorite side dishes gotta be mashed potatoes with gravy. My family, again, passed down basically like my grandmother, I'm sure her mother probably taught her, you know, my dad, I all know how to make a pretty mean thing of mashed potatoes. So
what about you, Karen?
I like that. Side dish. I'm not a huge Thanksgiving fan, but I do like some potatoes. So we're going to go with mashed potatoes, which apparently per the J School Dean's office, I am good at making. And I have a date with my stove later tonight to make some of my world famous from scratch mashed potatoes. Thank you, HelloFresh, for teaching me how to make them from scratch. Dessert, like Dylan, big pie fan, not pecan pie though. I do prefer an apple or a cherry. I will eat pumpkin pie as long as there's whipped cream to go with it. preferably if I'm going to have pumpkin pie, I want the pumpkin pie concrete from Andy's frozen custard. That's like vanilla custard, and then it has pieces of pie in it.
Haven't had?
Oh my god!
I'm intrigued.
It's so good.
Saw it on the menu. Thought about it. Didn't get it. May have to.
I've also had that. There's an apple pie one too, and a peach pie one during the summer. I've had all of them. Love pie mixed with vanilla frozen custard. So, yep. There we go. Well, now that we have that out of the way, let's move into in-season sports. And let's talk about that volleyball game on Friday, Matthew.
So for the first time since I believe it was October 6th, Mizzou volleyball has lost the game. This would have been 10 straight wins, unfortunately. For Tigers fans, they end up dropping the match to number 21, Florida. At the time, I think they've moved up into the top 20. You'll have to fact check me on that. I can double check that in a moment. But tough match, valiant effort. Tigers came out red hot. This was the fourth highest attended match in Missouri volleyball history. 6,379 fans. And Florida really, you know, did not have a good first set. You know, I think the fans played a role in that. Mizzou won 25-15. They just absolutely dominated in that set. Florida had some problems with attack errors early on. They bounced back in the second set, 25-21, to even it up heading into the third set. And for most of the third set, it was going Florida's way. But Mizzou made a really impressive comeback. They were down 24-20, ran off four consecutive points to tie it up, and then Florida goes on a 3-1 run to stop the potential comeback. Mizzou responds well in that fourth set. They end up winning it 25-22. Florida won the third set 27-25. Mizzou wins the fourth set 25-22. They're able to kind of hold off a late push by Florida, and then just really a disaster of a fifth set. Florida wins 15-6. They hit 600 in the fifth set. The highest they'd hit in any other set was 286. Mizzou ends up hitting -133 in the fifth set. So it really couldn't have gone any more poorly. I really think that third set was the key. At the time, I kind of felt like whoever won that one would end up winning the match, and that is how it ended up. Being, you know, I think Mizzou probably just expended so much energy trying to make that comeback in the third set, and then expended so much energy, you know, in that fourth set holding Florida off, that they really just didn't have much left in the tank when it came to that set five, which is something we haven't seen that often. Usually Mizzou's been pretty good in fifth sets, but some encouraging signs from that match. Mizzou again with 11 blocks. They've now had double-digit blocks in each of the last two matches. Those are the only two matches this year where they have had more than 9 blocks, where they've reached that threshold of 10. You know, you look at Colleen Finney had another really strong match. You know, she's been just so important to this team this season. Somebody who, you know, maybe flies under the radar a little bit for the more casual fan, but her impact on that team in terms of on the court and just leadership is absolutely tremendous. Looking at Mizzou after that match, 9-3 now in the SEC. They can still win it, and they would essentially have to go undefeated the rest of the way, right? They have 4 matches remaining against the 2 Mississippi schools. This weekend, they're both on the road. Then you have Kentucky. That is going to be the big one to watch for, and Auburn to close out the season. So the baseline expectation for the next 2 weeks is going to be 3-1. But if you go 4-0, and this
Who's
is
a the win, one?
Kentucky. Kentucky is a top 15 team right now. may very well end up hosting a regional, but that part of the importance of beating Kentucky, not only – can you possibly win a share of the SEC title? But that at least puts you back in the conversation, right, to host a regional. I don't know if it makes up for that Florida loss, but it at least brings you close. Kentucky currently ranked 12th by the AVCA. But, you know, looking
at – Florida is 20th, by the way.
Florida is 20th. Correct. Okay. But, you know, you look at where things are, and there's kind of a crazy scenario out there where Mizzou wins out. Kentucky has three matches left. They win two of them, lose one. They lose to Mizzou. Florida has three matches left. They went out. Texas has three matches left. They went out. In that scenario, all four teams would be 13-3 and earn a share of the SEC title. The SEC title not only has never been split by four teams, it's never been split by three teams. So this would be one of the craziest years that we've seen in SEC volleyball. The fact that, I mean, this is a very realistic scenario, right? You know, you look at these teams are going to be favored. Florida, Texas is going to be favored to win out. Mizzou could beat Kentucky, very easily could win out. The same thing for Kentucky, except for that Mizzou match. So this is a very realistic thing that can happen. Mm-hmm. NCAA tournament picture, Mizzou is around a sixth seed right now, I would say. If they have a strong final 2 weeks, they can get into five seed territory. If they run the table, maybe even a four seed. They would probably be like 15th or 16th seed in that scenario. And that would be very, very murky. You know, you don't know exactly what's going to happen there, but it's not completely off the table yet.
I have a question. Professor. what's the best seed that Mizzou's ever been in the tournament?
I'm not sure.
I've stumped you. I don't know the answer.
I think they've been in the top 10 in the country before, maybe even top eight. So I would say they've probably been a two seed or a three seed before would be my guess.
Okay.
So I don't think they're going to break any records in that fashion. But it has definitely been quite a while since Mizzou has hosted a region.
Well, which is what would happen if they're top. It definitely didn't happen during Joshua Taylor's tenure.
No, it did not. it definitely did not. I mean, even the fact that we're talking about them possibly hosting a regional, possibly winning a share of the SEC title. I mean, is it likely? No, Kentucky's going to be favored, but it is definitely a distinct possibility, right? You know, and this team just continues to exceed expectations. But the fact that we're even talking about it is a realistic thing that can happen in year two of the Don Sullivan era. Tells you everything you need to know about the job Dawn Sullivan has done at Mizzou. And she is one of the best coaches that Mizzou has right now, if not the best. She's definitely up there and one of the better coaches in NCAA volleyball, in my opinion.
So really, I almost wonder if having this loss for Florida makes them better prepared for Kentucky. I mean, I know they're
I wouldn't be shocked.
Not the same teams, but like, I don't know. I think I kind of feel like maybe it changes the motivation. I mean, not that they need motivation, but.
No, I can definitely understand where you're going. And I mean, realistically, if they wanted to win the SEC, Kentucky was probably a must win anyways. I think if they beat Florida, it's not necessarily a must win to host a regional, but you lose to Florida. It really is now. And I think the thing that gives them a shot is their defense. Their defense was nothing close to what it was. Their defense, when they faced Kentucky the last time, night and day from their defense right now. You know, I mean, you look at it, last time I checked, it was before the Florida match, so I'm not sure if things have changed. Mizzou was fourth in hitting percentage allowed, in opposing hitting percentage. And the SEC, during conference matches, they've moved down to fifth now, but they're still top five in the conference for a team that's also towards the top in hitting percentage. So this has become a balanced team. this was a offensive heavy team in the beginning. It has become much more balanced now, which is going to be very key for them in their NCAA tournament run.
Okay. What's their RPI now? Has that been updated?
22.
Again.
So 2 weeks ago, they were 22. Then they moved up to 17. Now they're back to 22.
Okay.
And I should quickly mention signing day. Mizzou signed 5, including Macalobaglio, 6'2", right side from Buenos Aires. She is actually a member of the Argentinian national team.
Nice.
She helped them finish second in the South American Championship, 9th at the World Championship. So she is going to be a hitter to look out for. Asia Harvey, 6 foot outside from Georgia. High school All-American this year, was the Georgia 3A player of the year. And according to the press release from Mizzou, was the 10th ranked player in the nation. I'm not sure if that was from Prep Volleyball, which is kind of the heads and shoulders above the best recruiting site for volleyball. So maybe take it with a small grain of salt. But any site listing you as the 10th overall recruit in the nation means that you're going to be pretty dang good. They also got a libero, Zoe Matias, from Miami, who was part of arguably the best club volleyball program in the country. Tri Volleyball Club won a 2024 AAU National Championship. She's also a 2-time AAU All-American. And then you have a 6'2 blocker, middle blocker from Austin, and Ashley Houston, and also a 6'2 outside hitter from Utah in Paige Felder.
Love it.
Something to note. This is going to be a story for the offseason. Looking at the number of people who will be theoretically returning, not saying that nobody goes in the transfer pool, right? Looking at the number of returns they have and the freshmen, that would put them over the roster limit, roster limit for the NCAA. So that will be something to watch in the offseason. But for now, Mizzou Volleyball seems very likely to be at least a 6 seed, if not a 5 seed, is where I would expect. I would predict them right now. I would say the most likely outcome is they go 3-1 and end up with a 5 seed to end the season. And one of the reasons that's interesting, another team that's kind of lurking around a 3-4 line, that's Tour of the West, KU. And they take geography into account in this tournament. So you very easily could see the border showdown play out in the NCAA tournament.
I asked you that a while back on who you thought your who you'd like to see Mizzou match up against, and you had mentioned that. Over the net, next guess, who are we eyeing?
Well, I'm looking at, because they have 2 road matches, it's a travel weekend. I'm travel day on Wednesday. Seem like that never really works out too well in terms of the interviewing. So I'm looking at next Monday or Tuesday for the next episode. And I am not 100% sure yet. It may depend on, you know, who does really well over the course of the next 2 matches. But one that we talked about is Naomi Franco, who I am planning to have on as a guest at some point.
Her, Dylan, I don't know if you saw it or any of our viewers, but her interview on Mizzou Volleyball social media channels were, it was pretty entertaining. And I was like, oh, that she needs to be a guest on the podcast. Also because she was at gymnastics on Saturday to cheer on her roommate. And I have questions about whether or not they try to teach each other skills. The one is about 6,000 feet taller than the other one. But yeah, she's a trip. I think that she would be a great guest.
Yeah, it's Naomi Franco, Sarah White, I think Michael Vernon as well, and then is it Amari Wright from gymnastics, who are all roommates?
Yes.
Yeah,
that's right. It's one gymnast and three volleyball players and multiple animals.
Yes, as we learned in my over-the-net interview with Michael Vernon earlier in the season, yes.
Yeah.
For student-athletes, several dogs and cats and other various pets, and a lot of chaos. A lot of chaos. Yes.
It seems a lot of energy in that household, it seems like.
Yeah.
Cool. Thank you, Matthew. Jumping over to women's basketball, Mizzou won, and you were there to see it in Macomb, Illinois.
Yes. So
let's talk about it.
They played one game since our last episode. They traveled to Western Illinois for a matchup against the Western Illinois Leathernecks in Macomb. I was fortunate enough to go. It was not really a packed environment, but it was a very tight-knit environment. They really just brought out all the nice chairs, filled it to as much as they could, brought the band out. Attendance under 2,000, but boy, was it a loud 2,000, a rowdy 2,000. Not too often you get a Power 5 team visiting someone, especially in the OVC. Really cool way to represent that. Another part of the attendance there was Quincy Notre Dame and their women's basketball team, because Quincy Notre Dame alum Abbey Schreacke, just about an hour away from Macomb, right along the Missouri-Illinois border. So she had a bunch of her family, friends in attendance, the Schreacke Collective as well. And boy, did she put on a show. This was the Abbey Schreacke show from basically the moment the second quarter started till the third quarter ended. Just ridiculous shot making. Not going to bury the lead. Mizzou won 75-55, but it mostly came off the back of Abbey Schreacke. 26 points, 8 threes. A couple of them were wide open, but oftentimes it was working off screens, hands in her face, wasn't doing a lot of dribbling, but was getting the ball in good positions and wasn't afraid to let it fly. I said she might be Mizzou's Klay Thompson, and she looked a lot like Klay Thompson in that performance. 8 for 12 from 3, shooting 66%. Just a flamethrower on offense, and having that sort of weapon off the bench was crucial for Mizzou. Other interesting headlines from that game, Ashton Judd came off the bench as well. They decided to go with a two-point guard look of Avery Kroenke and Nia Wilson, which, again, Robin Pitchin said she was going to be changing up a lot of the rotations and a lot of who was starting, but I did not expect to see Ashton Judd move to the bench. Overall, had a pretty solid game, put up some solid points. I think Nia Wilson, back in her starting role, looked extremely impressive when he was able to put up double digits, just continuing to work her way, comfortability as a Tiger. Other players, Lanaya Randall, extremely limited in her first half. She picked up, it was either two or three fouls, basically sat the whole second quarter, came back in the third and really helped seal that coffin into the Leathernecks after it was pretty close at halftime, but finished the game with 11 points, 9 rebounds, and only 15 minutes for a near double-double.
Nice.
Grace Slaughter continues to be the queen of consistency, 14 points, 6 rebounds, saw the most action at 32 minutes. And what was just the Tigers' most complete win of the season, you win by 20 on the road, struggled a little bit early, but really found their rhythm in that second and third quarter especially. Mm-hmm. Scored 18-23-19 to end the game after only scoring 15 points in the first quarter. So the offense is really starting to hum. You're getting to see a lot more pieces getting involved, not afraid to take shots. Rebounding was also extremely impressive. Out-rebounded their opponents 48-31, so finally able to show some of that dominance on the glass. Mentioned that Lanaya Randall was the primary one. Grace Slaughter also finished with 6, but just a bunch of players somewhere between 3 and 5. So everyone was crashing the glass. It was a very, very impressive game for women's basketball as they are now starting to turn a corner. Again, we mentioned that rough start. They were either 500 or below 500 to start the year. Now at 3-2, you got a couple home games coming up. Big time tournament in Florida. Coach P has been saying that there's a lot more to this team than meets the eye. The momentum is starting to roll. We'll see if they can continue to pick this up for the next 2 to 4 games before we have our next episode.
Sounds like a great game. Can't wait for part 2 to come out.
So tomorrow.
Yes.
SLU.
Yes.
Tigers Giving or whatever they're.
I think it's called Fansgiving for this.
Fansgiving. That makes more sense. I was like, that seems wrong after.
It's called Mallow's Giving, actually.
Yeah. So that's tomorrow. The giveaway's a mug. Maybe with some surprises in it. You will be there to cover it. Yes.
Yes. This will be me and Quentin Corpule, who will be back next episode. So he will have some thoughts on that game. I'll throw up some things on Rock M Plus. This SLU team, now under year three under Rebecca Tillett. She's turned this program around. They made the NCAA tournament in year one, beat Mizzou in year two in St. Louis. It was a pretty close matchup, but that SLU offense was just able to pull away late. So this is kind of a revenge game, especially for someone like Ashton Judd or Grace Slaughter, who that game is definitely fresh in their mind heading into tomorrow. The SLU team doesn't appear up to snuff as these last couple years. They're kind of struggling, had a tough double-digit loss to Southern Indiana, who just moved up to D1. So look at Mizzou, and again, this team years past hasn't been ideal, prone to losing these type of matchups, but this SLU team doesn't appear to be the same animal or the same beast that it was last year. Now, with the fact that you bundle it, it is in Columbia. Tigers, you feel pretty good about them coming out on top, preferably by double digits.
I like the sound of that. And then they're going to Destin, which you had already said.
We got one more game before then, actually. I believe
Another game before they go to Destin. It's
Friday
another
morning.
Game between SLU before they go to Destin.
It's on Friday morning against
Little. Oh my God, I totally forgot about it. You're right, because I won't be there because I'll be working.
I'm pretty sure it's the Columbia Public Schools game. It's happening at 11:30. Hopefully we can get some nice media brunch there is my hope. This Little Rock team as well, they're kind of a Jekyll and Hyde situation. They held really close against Arkansas, who's another SEC team that struggled early before eventually losing in overtime. Then went on the road to play teams like Auburn and Kansas State and lost by 30+. So seeing this Little Rock team, if not only can Mizzou win, but if they can truly kind of bury the hatchet and kind of dominate this game onwards from the second half, will show you if this team is really improving or if it is just all talk and a couple nice games here and there.
Yeah. And then they go to Destin.
Then they go to Destin. Open it up against the Syracuse team that made it to the second round of the NCAA tournament last year. Again, struggling, missed some pieces, lost to a surprisingly very good St. Joe's team, but still probably not up to standard. And then depending on that, you'll play either Creighton or Wichita State. Mm-hmm. Creighton just dropped out of the top 25. Wichita State is not very good. They don't contend in the Americans. So coming out of that, I think there's a chance the Tigers go 2-0, but there is no world I really see them finishing 0-2. I think 1-1 is probably your most likely outcome there. Anything after that is probably found change.
Okay. What sorts of things are we looking for them to focus on in their next couple?
I think it's really just like figure out your guards, like, because it's kind of a mess when it comes to your starters and the first ones off the bench. Grace Slaughter, Lanaya Randall, Angie Gallicolendi, those are stuck. Those are your three starters you know you're getting. Then it's been a combination of Avery Kroenke, Ashton Judd, and Nia Wilson, who have all kind of rotated around each other for two spots. And that's not even mentioning Abbey Schreacke, who I don't know how much longer you can keep her away from that starting spot just with the offensive firepower that she brings and the defensive presence that she will pull. Having Grace Slaughter and Abbey Schreacke at the court on the same time and their ability to shoot the ball from deep totally stretches a defense out. And the more that we can see those two in the lineup together, the more successful this Mizzou team is going to be. So I really think it's about figuring out your starting five as we inch closer and closer to SEC play. My pitch for these next couple games, try throwing out Avery at your point guard. She's been really good recently. A lot of assists, very few turnovers, which is something that Robin is really going to promote.
She started the Western Illinois game, didn't she?
She started Western Illinois, and then she started the game before that, which would have been, oh gosh, it was after Norfolk State, but after Southern as well.
Was that Tulane?
That would have been. Yes, thank you. That would have been Tulane as well.
I'd like to forget that game, but it did occur.
Kroenke had a very good game. I believe it was 6 assists, 2 turnovers. So while she's not really a scoring threat, she's going to be an elite-level passer, an elite-level on-ball defender to go along with Lanaya Randall. So I think what you can expect from a starting five like that is you're going to have your main scorers of Abbey Schreacke and Grace Slaughter, who, again, are going to primarily work on the outside but can work their way in. Your defenders like Lania Randall and Avery Kroenke, and then Angie Gallicolani, who's going to guard that paint on both sides. That would be my pitch. You never quite know with Coach P and her tendency to kind of switch up these lineups, but I'm going to be very intrigued who hits the court first and what, if those starting five are what it is, what they can do in that matchup.
One more question. I didn't see the game. I meant to watch it over the weekend and forgot. I don't know. Forgot. did Tree or Demila play?
Demila got in during garbage time, pretty much. It was her and Lucy that came off the bench in those last 2 minutes when they're up by 20. After that, Tiana Heron did not see the court at all. Went through warm-ups, everything looked okay. Appeared to have just been a coach's decision. So it seems very clear that whatever preseason expectations we had of Demila Brown are very different than what coach is seeing and what they're trying to implement.
So she was good during that exhibition game.
Those are my thoughts as well. There's a very crowded, just very good guard room here, and it just doesn't look like there's going to be room for much of Demila right now. But it's good to know that you have a player like that who's just a plug and play. Suppose, God forbid, anyone does get hurt. It's a long, grueling season. Sometimes players need rest. Sometimes tweaks happen. So just knowing that you have someone like Demila, at the very least, available and ready, even if she's not seeing consistent minutes, is at least inspiring if you're Coach P.
Okay. Thank you. I'm going to pivot to swimming real quick. It'll take like 2 seconds. Swimming is in Georgia, Athens. Right now, actually, they left on Monday. They put out a nice little social media video using the great song, The Devil Went Down to Georgia. So they are in Georgia for an invitational with a bunch of SEC schools. We talked about this a little bit last week. The meet is Wednesday through Friday. You can watch it on SEC Plus. It is, it turns out, a prelim final format. So prelims are every morning at 9:30, and finals will air at 5:30, except on Friday they are at 5:00. I'm going to try to keep tabs on it on this Meet Mobile app and try to share results as I see it and possibly do some sort of recap at the end, just since Grievers really did seem to be excited about this meet and them resting and wearing tech suits. I'm expecting to see some fast times, especially against some really good competition. So that's all I got on the swimming. Told you it'd be fast. Wrestling, Matthew, Virginia Tech lost.
Wrestling going up against another top 10 opponent in Virginia Tech in Blacksburg. They end up losing that one 23-10. Once again, Noah Certain, Rocky Elam both out to begin this season. I think it was the press conference. They said that expecting them to be back in a couple of weeks. Didn't really give an exact timeline for that. But right now they're starting two true freshmen, Gage Walker and Aiden Sinclair, in the place of Certain and Elam. Walker, pretty good outcome. Lost a 6-5 decision, but he did so to a top 15 wrestler in Eddie Ventresca. Really tough for a true freshman, and he acquitted himself pretty well. Cade Moore drops a 3-0 decision to number 10 Connor McGonigal. Moore just hasn't looked like the guy that we saw last year in the regular season. They said that he's been dealing with an injury to begin the year. Not sure how much of a factor that's been, but he just really hasn't had any offense. He hasn't been effective on the attack. Josh Edmond, some concerns there as well. Drops a 4-2 decision to Sam Latona. You know, he's looked a little bit closer to the wrestler we saw towards the beginning of last year than at the end when he had his breakthrough, where, you'd like to see him be a little bit more aggressive, more explosive. He has that ability. We saw it at the end of last year. He just hasn't really tapped into that much this season. He's had a lot of low scoring matches. Similar issue with Logan Joffrey. He loses 9-0 to Caleb Henson, the defending national champion. So nothing too crazy there. But, you know, Joffrey's had a lot of really low scoring matches. You know, this front half of the lineup, including Jay Conway, who lost 11-3 to Rafael Hippolito, is just really underwhelmed at the beginning of this year. You know, none of them have really stood out. We've seen the potential from Edmund before. We've seen it from Conway before. You've seen it from Moore before. But none of them have really looked like they've been wrestling their best or wrestling to the ability that we've seen them do, that we've seen them have before. You know, starts to get better in the back end, though. By that point, Missouri's already down 17-0. Yeah. But Cam Steed wins an 8-1 decision over Mac Church. Really good. He's been one of the most promising wrestlers on this team. Gets a couple of takedowns there in that match. Keegan O'Toole. But got a 13-5 major decision over Lennox Wolak, the fourth-ranked wrestler at 174. So this was really his first major test, right, at this weight class, at least in terms of in the NCAA season. And he passes with flying colors. I mean, this should have been a tech fall. O'Toole just – Wolak had some really good defense and scrambles where O'Toole just continued to shoot and shoot and shoot. And he would get in on the leg. He'd get it on the ankle. And he would bring Wolak to the mat multiple times, but he couldn't get that takedown. He finally started to score, and the floodgates kind of open. And you could tell he was relentless to the point that Wolak at the end of – you know, that match was just lying down on the mat, gasping for air. He was just absolutely exhausted. O'Toole just completely broke him down. Like I said, should have been a tech fall, but O'Toole still had a major decision in, you know, what theoretically you might say was kind of an underwhelming match for him. Really solid nonetheless. Colton Hawks, this is the big one. 8-2 decision over Thomas Stewart Jr., who was the ACC champion at 184 last year and finished 7th at the NCAA championships to be an All-American. So Hawks takes down the All-American. He was had a loss in the blood round last year at the NCAA championships, meaning he fell just short of becoming an All-American. That will be the goal for him this season. Had some really good defensive scrambling, really strong defense in the first period. Stewart nearly got a takedown. Hawks somehow won the scramble. He ended up getting the takedown, almost had some near fall points as well. 4-1 entering the third period. Stewart quickly escapes. He's within 2 points. A takedown would give him the lead. Hawks uses his power to work around Stewart for a takedown, rode out the period to secure the extra point for riding time. This is as much as you could hope for from Hawks. Absolutely phenomenal performance. 197, Andy Smith beats freshman Aiden Sinclair 12-9. Smith dominated in the second period. There wasn't much action in the first. Smith dominates in the second period. And then Sinclair starts to figure things out. Remember, he's a true freshman, highly, highly, highly rated recruit. He starts to figure things out on Smith in the third period, and all of a sudden, it's a 12-9 match. He gets two takedowns. He's not just getting takedowns. He's letting Smith up to go for more points, trying to come back and make this thing a real match. He can't get the final takedown. You know, he had about 30, 45 seconds left. Smith ends up playing defense and just narrowly avoids the upset 12-9, but really encouraging sign from Sinclair. I said, he is such a promising wrestler, such a talented wrestler. He's going to be a lot of fun to watch at 197. And then Seth Nitzel drops a 4-2 decision at 285 pounds at heavyweight. You know, looked really good riding, you know, rode out the second period. He chose to go top in the third period. You don't see that too often. That's a little bit more common to heavyweight. Reminds me of Zach Elam a little bit in terms of his ability to ride, but wasn't able to get any back points, which is what he needed for that match, and wasn't really able to get anything going when they were wrestling from neutral and wrestling, you know, standing up. So overall, you know, we didn't see this full team. We haven't really seen what this team can look like when it's fully healthy yet. There have been some signs for concern. You know, the offense really isn't clicking for some wrestlers throughout the first couple of weeks. But, you know, once you get these guys back to full health, that's going to just take some stress off of those guys in the first half of the lineup, especially having no certain back as the opener. So
yeah, because that kind of worries me that they start – so far behind, and then it's like kind of on the later people to bring it back up. That
I mean, this was really really good competition too. You know, most of these Virginia Tech guys were top 20, top 15, top 10 in the country. But even so, you know, it's really the offense and the lack of takedowns is, I think, the main issue for this team right now. I said, we haven't seen them at full strength. We haven't seen, you know, this team reach its potential yet. It's early in the season, you know, in the wrestling world. Honestly, there are really only two meets that matter, the Big 12s and the NCAA championships, you know, but the rest of it matters because it helps you with your rankings, right? And it helps with seeding for those tournaments. So a long way to go. No really big signs for panic yet, but some things that Mizzou definitely needs to work on, and if they continue to go unfixed, may begin to be more causes for concern.
So Thursday they head to Champaign to take on Illinois.
Correct. Yep.
Correct. How is Illinois?
I believe that Illinois overall is a top 20. They're 16th in intermats tournament rankings. They have a couple of solid wrestlers. For example, you have at 184, this is going to be an interesting one to watch, Edmund Ruth. He was at 174 last year, was a top 10 seed at the NCAA tournament. I believe made All-American, if I remember correctly. But that's going to be another big matchup with Colton Hawks, who's now moved up to 11th. So that's going to be probably the biggest one to watch. There aren't any other Illinois wrestlers that I just can immediately, you know, rattle off in my head as being at the top of their weight class. Okay, looking through, Lucas Bird at 133 is ranked second. He's 6-0. He's a senior right now. That will be one to watch, although likely going to favor Illinois there, 141. This is going to be a good one. Danny Pacino for Illinois. He's a junior. We're going to see Josh Edmond, okay, just how much is he struggling right now? Is he just had some really incredibly tough competition to open the year? Can he get his first rank victory, I believe, of the season? And that will be one to watch as well.
I like this one to watch when we're not even sure we'll be able to watch it.
Well, that's true. Let's see, is there any more news? Nothing on the Mizzou site about.
So yeah, I don't even know if. Well, they don't. Like my dad and I were talking about the wrestling team and how it's hard, even though like you have these great updates and everything, it's hard to follow along because they make it so damn hard to like actually watch them on TV.
Yeah.
Without shelling out a crap ton of money, or like, it's not like they just put it on SEC Network Plus, since they're whatever Big 12 channel or whatever they have. So I really feel like they're doing the sport a injustice by not making it more readily available to the public.
Thinking about it now, because it is hosted by Illinois, it's possible that maybe on
Big Ten Plus or something.
Yeah, which I don't think I have access to, so I'm not sure if I'll be able to watch it. How much of an update I'll be able to provide? You know, I can comment on the results if nothing else as they come in.
Yeah.
But that's just one of the unfortunate things. Every once in a while, you know, you just get a match where you don't really have access to it.
Yeah. That's true. I feel like if it was going to be on Big Ten Plus, they'd have something listed, you know, like little blurb, like this is where you can watch it. So that's annoying. But thank you, Matthew. Go Tiger.
I know I should have.
And order Brian Smith's book. Oh,
shoot.
Oh, so did someone already get it?
We're good. And he was too ecstatic to go show off.
I got it.
Oh, my gosh. You should get it autographed by him. Not professional?
I did almost forget to mention Mizzou just brought in the fourth best class in the country. As Dylan, you know what? You should just keep dancing in the background as I describe the recruiting class. I feel like that would be entertaining. Alrighty, so a bunch of top 100 recruits.
You have
Dom Bambinelli at, I think, 165, 174 out of Georgia, ranked 28th in the nation. You have, let's see here, some of the other notable ones. Seth Mendoza, he is a top 10 recruit. Ninth overall recruit by Flow Wrestling, 125 pounds. He is going to be a name to watch for a long time for Mizzou. Rockstar recruit, Colin Rath out of Pennsylvania. For those who follow wrestling, you know Pennsylvania takes their wrestling very seriously, the entire state. 23rd ranked recruit in this class, placed at Super 32s, which is really, really big. Samson Stillwell, the heavyweight, 34th ranked recruit. He is the long-term future at heavyweight. You have Seth Nitzel, who's going to be your next, who's going to be here this year or next year. After that, it will most likely be Samson Stillwell's turn. He represented Team USA at the U-17 World Championships. And then you have Peyton Westfall out of Liberty, Missouri, arguably the best high school program in the state, and he was ranked 68th in the nation.
What is Dylan doing?
Hey, I had to put on a show. What can I say?
Okay. Anyway, thank you, Matthew. Just a couple more things, you guys. We are at Out of Season Sports now, and it's Karen's time to talk. Let's hope I keep the coughing at bay. So, me and Cal Tobias Photo and Matthew all were at, as well as a good amount of other people, were at the gymnastics intrasquad meet on Saturday.
And Mizzou Volleyball's Naomi Franco and Sarah White.
Yes, came to support the roomies. It was great. It was great. That's my thoughts on that. We got to see the long-awaited return, Helen Hu, and Matthew, who has never seen a Helen Hu beam routine in person, got to see it. It was majestic as hell. It was beautiful. She had 995. There were judges there. They brought in judges, usually from St. Louis or Kansas City. Shannon will ship some people in to help out with this, but she did get a 995. She's so talented. I'm like at a loss for words watching her on beam. She's so good. And I know I said it before we started recording, so I'll share it here, is that what makes her different and so like universally, universally beloved by the gym internet, is that she does her beam a little bit different than a lot of other gymnasts do. Like, her routine is far different than any of the other 13 routines that we watch for beam, because she doesn't focus as much on like acrobatic series and doing flips and all this other stuff. Like, her skill set is much more about showing off her length and like her extreme strength and like holding these crazy poses for what feels like eternity. And it's like so graceful, and it's amazing. it's amazing. So she was a high scorer on the beam. Thank you to Matthew for helping me with some of the scoring. here. So she was the high scorer with the 9.95. And then there also were quite a good amount of 9.85s, which was the second highest, including freshman Rayleigh Jackson, who I think also she performs very tall because she's like, she's not actually that tall, but like she has very long limbs, and when she's performing, it makes her look like a giant. She had a 9.85. That was awesome. Shannon Welker did say afterwards that that was somebody to keep an eye on. She did three out of the four events. Also getting 9.85s were San Jose State transfer, though he said that we should stop calling them transfers because that makes them feel like they're not a part of the team. But that's just my way of saying, like, she's newer. and you may not be familiar with her name. Lauren McPherson, she got a 9.85. She did the all around. Amy Weir from Oklahoma, St. Louis native. She had a 9.85. That was really good. And Raina Light, sophomore from Florida, and Addison Lawrence, who I know I've mentioned on many other occasions. She missed all of last season with hip surgery, and she had a 9.85 also. There were a bunch that had some struggles with some pretty major balance checks, so there were a decent amount of people that did score like 9.65 or lower on beam, but Shannon said not to worry, everybody is where they should be. As far as the other events, didn't see a score for bars outside of Lauren McPherson's 9.80. I was most impressed, I think, with Amari's bars. I've missed watching her bar routine, especially her crazy dismount that is named after her.
She struck that landing too, didn't she?
Yes. And it's just so different. It's such a, like, if you watch a lot of gymnastics, which I know not many people do, like most people do the same double layout landing, which is like, your body is like this, and you, good thing that's closed, huh? And you flip twice. So you're basically just like flipping around twice with your body stretched out straight. She does this crazy dismount named the Celestine, and it's just cool to look at. I don't know.
So I have a question for you for bars, Karen.
Yeah.
Something I noticed was, you know, obviously one of the main things to look for with bars is, you know, being within that like 10 degree range, right? When you're at the top, so like your hands are on the bars, your feet are up in the air, you want to be 90, you know, it seemed like you were kind of at being like 75 or 70 or going over a lot of the time. Is that something to be concerned about, or something that you'll just kind of usually see when there's kind of a lower stress environment, or when it's earlier in the year?
And I had marked down on my notes some issues with handstands, but Shannon said afterwards he was happy with
that surprised
the handstands, especially out of the returners. And that's who I saw the most issues on handstands with. Yeah. I don't know. But like, Mara, for example, Mara Tatarsely, she had a couple of handstands, I thought, that were definitely over that 10 degrees mark. But yeah, he said that he was happy with the handstands. Well, I guess I'll see in mid-December if they have improved, but ideally you do want it in like that 10 degree,
because I think if you don't, from what I remember watching the broadcast, if you're not within 10 degrees of 90, then you get deducted points.
Yes.
So I feel like if it's an issue again, when you see them in December, then it's probably a cause for concern.
Yeah.
But as of right now, it's still early.
It's mid-November.
The team was really good on bars from what I remember last year. And the lineup theoretically should be absolutely stacked. So, I don't feel too concerned. But
yeah,
that was just something that
only one freshman got in on the bars lineup. Lisa Siebert was the only freshman that got into the bars. So I thought that was pretty interesting as well. We do both, Nate and I, think that Olivia Kelly will eventually end up on bars as well, but she has a bit of a wrist injury. She had a scooter malfunction over the summer and ended up with a wrist brace for up until pretty recently. So she still did three events, but she probably a little bit hard grip strength and things like that for a bars routine when you're coming back from a wrist injury. In terms of vault, Shannon said that right now they have 5 10.0 start value vaults. We did see 5 10.0 start value vaults. Some of them were incredible. Hannah Horton, she stuck that landing. She got a 995. Jocelyn, and she will agree with me, was lowballed on her. She stuck her landing, went sky high, only got a 985. So I have some words for those judges because she deserved better. Let me see who else on that. The vault scores across the board were a little bit low. I felt like a lot of 9.8s, but there are five people that have 10.0 start value vaults. That is awesome. He said he thinks that they will have at least two more. When asked, he was like, he didn't know. And he's like, oh, wait, I should know, right? And said freshman Rayleigh Jackson and sophomore Kennedy Griffin were likely the next two on there. They didn't show them off because they didn't feel like they were really at a point where they wanted to show them off to the public yet. And then lastly, floor. Oh, my God. This team's floor routines are so freaking amazing. Just unreal. I had Kylie Menard, sophomore. If that girl does not get into a lineup at Hearns this year for people to watch that crazy ass floor routine that she has, they would be missing out because it is the wildest choreography I've ever seen. It's like out of a horror movie. Like there's like some weird exorcism looking stuff there with their limbs going weird ways. And it's incredible. Like my jaw was on the floor watching that thing. And I told Jackie that after the meet, and she was like, thank you. Kylie's been working very hard on that. So she is definitely one to watch, and she scored a 9.9. So she's got to be in the lineups in my book. Kennedy Griffin, new viral floor routine, Beyonce themed, not the same as last year. Amazing. She scored 9.95. Jocelyn rounded out the whole competition with a 9.95. Also new choreography. Actually, they all have new choreography. And then, of course, we have Hannah Horton with her Michael Jackson themed music, 9.9. Oh, and another one I really liked, though the only one I didn't catch a score on, was Rayleigh Jackson, who did a Black Swan theme for hers. But the choreo is looking great. Some of them had full routines. Some of them are still going halfway across and tumbling onto larger mats that'll by mid-December, like, they will have to have the whole thing by that black and gold meet. But yeah, just really awesome. Really awesome. It was super fun. Good times. Good crowd. Fun stuff. And then the last thing I will wrap up with is softball. God, I feel like we've been waiting on this for like 6,000 years. They released the first breadcrumbs of a schedule on September 11th. And now what's the date? November 19th. So November 18th, we finally got a whole schedule. 2 months later. That's ridiculous. So some quick facts. Oh, y'all, this schedule is scary. There is not a rest in here. So the Tigers are facing 37 different opponents on the 2025 schedule. Only 6 of them had a losing record. Only 4 had winning records, but under 30 wins. 11 of the 37 had between 30 and 35 wins. 6 had between 35 to 39 wins. 6 had 40 to 49 wins. And 3 had more than 50 wins. 12 made it just to the first round of the NCAA tournament before getting eliminated. 3 made it to super regionals. And 6, as someone reminded me on Twitter today, out of the 8 total teams in the Women's College World Series, forgot that part of it, 6 made it to the Women's College World Series. And then, of course, 1 was crowned national champion again. Again. So, yeah, this is wild. I am working on an extremely long schedule piece because 37 opponents is a lot of words. Maybe I'll break up some of it. I don't know. I'm getting there. I'm chugging along. So yeah, it's going to be a crazy season for the Tigers. Yeah. You have any thoughts on it, Dylan?
Just like you said, loaded schedule from top to bottom. That's one of the things I appreciate about softball. They do not mince words. They do not duck opponents. You just play the teams and you play a lot of them. You play them in quick succession and they're almost always good. A couple of like mainstay ones, Oklahoma and Texas, both come into Columbia for the first time in a while. Both elite programs, obviously. One of the more fun ones, KU, will make its return to Columbia after the border war last year in Kansas. Having that come back here, the Mizzou tournaments, or no, the Mizzou Invitational is back in Columbia after a year off. So get to see some good mid-major opponents, including...
And Michigan is coming in.
Which I believe, I'll probably butcher this, but Bella Norton, one of their new coaches, is a Michigan alum.
You're right. Yeah, then, they won 43 games a year ago.
Very good team. Included another team is South Dakota State, who they also play in the Wichita State Invitational. And they also have played like the past 2 years, at least twice, I think. They love playing the Jackrabbits.
Fun fact, my great-great-aunt I was talking about, where we get the pecan pie recipe from, went to South Dakota State.
There you go.
That is a truly
final thing I'll mention,
fun fact.
Final one I'll mention, early highlight, first weekend of the season, you close out the Clearwater Invitational in a rematch against Duke, which I think is going to be so much fun just to wrap up that tournament. Hopefully both teams coming into it 4-0, but you never know. So just, again, like you mentioned, loaded schedule, but just going to be another blast of a year for Coach LA and her squad.
Another rematch with UCF, which they seem to do every year. Well, last year I did find like last year they didn't visit UCF. UCF was one of their opponents at Mary Nutter. But the year before that, they actually, during their extensive Florida excursion, they stopped in Orlando and faced UCF. And then they're doing that again this year. I was trying to think of who else. Oh, they faced Nebraska twice. Nebraska is kind of a weird, like, they're probably the only team that I'm going to call out in my piece as being, as knowing that it's a completely different team with Jordy Ball than who they didn't have last year because she got hurt and was out the whole season. And she has since recruited a crap ton of players to come play with her. So I think Nebraska only won like 31 games or something a year ago. Like, this is going to be a really, really good matchup for the Tigers. So it's going to be rough. My parents are super excited because they get to spend the first two weekends in February seeing the team play. They did this last year too. Well, it's like the Clearwater Invitational, and then the other, is the other one in Clearwater too? Or one's in St. Pete or something like that. They're both like right there, like down the street. So they're really excited about that.
Hold on.
And then Mizzou baseball has a tournament on the other side of Florida.
Yeah, they won't be at that one.
So yeah, they're both in Clearwater, just have different names. So
both in Clearwater. Oh, yeah, one's like Shriners and one's the NFCA Leadoff Classic. Is that
Nailed it.
Oh, so smart. And then at the end of the month, they're going to the Swamp to see Mizzou face Florida in gymnastics. So lots of Tiger activity for the Steger fam. But anyway, that's all for softball. And that about wraps things up here. So please head to rockmnation.com. Read all of our work, so much work. Follow Rock M Radio on your preferred social media platform as well as your preferred podcast platform. Leave us reviews. Love comments. I left a comment on our last one, hoping to spark the conversation. Something along the lines of, can someone get Karen a cough drop? And no one said anything back. It was like I made a joke about myself. It was very sad. You can also support us by getting a subscription to our service, RockM.plus. It is $5 a month and well worth the cost of admission. And I forgot this last week, but you should follow us on Twitter, I guess, if people are still using that. We all are still using it. I am at Karen Steger. Matthew is at M_Gustafson27. Dylan is at Dylan R. Heinrich. Quentin's not here, so, or Rory or Abigail. So screw them. Dylan and I are also on Blue Sky, along with some other Rock M people. Haven't gotten Matthew over there yet. So
it'll happen eventually.
Happen eventually.
Join the train. Hop on the bandwagon.
Yeah,
we have cookies, maybe.
Water's warm. And not hate-filled. So, you know, that's nice. No bots. All right. So, MIZZOU. Awesome. Oh. And we're not recording again until December 1st. So you won't see our beautiful faces for a little bit. I know you'll be sad, you guys. Everyone have a happy Thanksgiving. Hope you have a great time with your family.
Get yourself some pecan pie.
Pecan pie. Or whatever pie you would like. All right. Well, see you later. Bye.
Thank you, everyone, for tuning in to Rock M Radio, a proud partner of Fans First Sports Network. Rock M Radio is the official podcast network of Rock M Plus, a new and exciting subscription service provided by me and the other voices of Rock M Radio. Please take a few moments to head over to rockm.plus and sign up for an account today. The cost is only $5 a month, and the benefits include access to our live podcast, a subscriber-only message board, weekly newsletters, and more. If you enjoyed this episode of Rock M Radio and would like to see more just like it beamed directly into your personal device, make sure to click the subscribe button below and tell your friends. Our podcast feed is available through the Apple Podcast app for iPhone, Google Podcast app for Android, whatever app you listen to your podcast. You can also find Rock M Radio on Spotify. If you're looking for a podcast about your favorite team that is not the Missouri Tigers, Fan First Sports Network is your answer. A full podcast network loaded with the team-specific podcasts covering Major League Baseball, the NFL, NHL, NBA, MLS, and more. And we'll be back with more episodes of Rock M Radio coming to you soon.